I thought of something I wanted to tell you all about. I recently was asked to be an advisor to the Alabama Democratic Reform Caucus. Sitting there, Representative Patricia Todd is also an advisor, and I would like to tell you what this caucus is. In case you don't know, the Democratic Party in Alabama is, dysfunctional is a very nice way I can put it. That's why we have a totally Republican-run government here. It's not that we do not have Democrats in this state. It's that we do not get out to vote, and we do not see the leadership coming from the state party that we would need to see. So, members of the Alabama Democratic Executive Committee, they're elected all over the state. Every voting district has two, a male and a female. And in order to make change in Alabama, we have to work within the party system. And this is something I really didn't understand until the first caucus meeting. When Representative Patricia Todd, and do we all know who Patricia is?
Yes.
Yes. When she was elected to her district in Birmingham, the state, Joe Reed and the state executive board challenged her election because they did not want Patricia Todd to have her office in the House of Representatives. And so I didn't realize that when we vote for someone and that election is won, that then the state party can challenge those elections because that person's a member of their party. And we need to make a lot of changes. So the Alabama Democratic Reform Caucus, ADRC, is on Facebook. We're looking for people all over the state. We're looking for people to run for these executive committee positions in each voting district, and then you would go to the state meetings. It's a huge uphill battle, and some people would say there isn't actually much hope until some people die. But we've thought that for a long time in some of our LGBTQ struggles as far as many things go. But I hold out hope. So the Alabama Democratic Reform Caucus, whenever they spoke about the diversity in this meeting, LGBTQ community was right there, spoken of, and being upheld with every other population. So I'd like to encourage you to look into it and contact them through Facebook if you would like to be someone in your voting district, a male or a female. And right now, we need to work toward other genders also, but that needs to be a step along the way. And get involved, because without voting, and now I understand, without getting involved in the party, we're not going to make significant changes in Alabama. So Representative Todd and I are there advocating for the LGBT community, and we would love for you to get involved in your community.
Introduce our next speaker. I'm going to be opening up the floor to everyone that's here, and if you have something you'd like to share and something you'd like to tell about your organization or would like to speak on the subject, we would love to hear from you. So be thinking about that when we get done with this young lady that I'm sure everyone knows. She needs no further introduction, and that is our very own Tori Wolf Sisson. So I'm just going to quickly just preface what I'm about to say with that I appreciate every one of you for being here. I appreciate every one of you for responding to my text messages, my phone calls, my emails, my Facebook invites, my messages. I have overly communicated with the grand majority of you, and I very much appreciate you for communicating back and for being here. Earlier this morning, some of you may not have been here, but I'm sure feeling the energy that QBell brought in, our ancestors brought in, all of our people and all of our support systems, both seen and unseen. And so, and just in that vein, and recognizing that this is a really historic moment, and we're privileged to be able to be standing here, to be in this moment, to be in this space, that a lot of people who I'm sure you're connected to or related to in some way may not have even imagined was possible. And so I'm going to do the Asada mantra, the Asada chant, or however you've heard it. I'll say it once, and then I'll just do a call and response. Is everybody okay with that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I'll just go through it once. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. I'm glad that y'all know what to do then. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love each other and protect each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. And so, let me begin. I'll say the first part, and we'll say the second, and then we'll just keep going. So, it is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
It is our duty to win.
We must love each other. And protect each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chance.
I'm going to do it during my time. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win.
We must love each other.
And protect each other. We have nothing to lose but our chance. It's louder. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love each other.
And protect each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chains. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love each other. And protect each other. Because why?
Because we have nothing to lose but our chains.
All right. Thank you so much, Tori. And I just want to say, you know, you and I have been having some discussions. And sometimes the folks around you don't appreciate what you do. But I want you to know that every single person here appreciates what you do.
Yes,
y'all give me Tori a hand.
We love you, Tori.
It doesn't matter what city in Alabama you come from, you save her time. You give her some love. Ladies and gentlemen, what we are witnessing here today, what you are part of standing here today, is the birth of an equality coalition of the state of Alabama.
Yeah! Yeah!
It is the birth of solidarity within the gay community of Alabama.
Yeah!
And we will not let it die.
No!
Will you let it die?
No!
Do you want it to live? Then that's what we're going to do.
Yeah.
Right here, right now, ladies and gentlemen, I believe he's back. Is Cliff Beach over there? Cliff, oh, he's on his way back from the car? Okay. All right. Well, do y'all mind if y'all catch you for a minute? Because I do want to take a time and a moment to say thank you. You know, thank you to each and every one of you for coming out here, for supporting your own rights, for supporting and protecting the freedoms of every minority within the justice system. You know, back in January when we did that first rally, you know, I was ready to do it. I didn't care if anybody showed up.
Yes.
But I'll be honest with you. In my little corner of Alabama, things had gotten kind of scarce. My gay community had dried up. So I honestly just simply went and did it because I knew that there were people who maybe didn't have the chance or didn't have the opportunity to do it. And when I walked up here and I stood up here, 125 people appeared from nowhere. And my faith in my community was reaffirmed and will stand strong to the end of my days. And I want you not to make the same mistake that I was making. Just because you don't see a strong gay community where you are, don't think that there is not a strong gay community where you are. There is. You are that community. You have the opportunity to go back and tell people that I saw the birth of the Equality Coalition of Alabama today on September the 28th. No matter what else happens, no matter whether we find victory here or whether we have to go on to the Justice Department and the United States of America in Washington, D.C. to get what we need, the Equality Coalition of Alabama will stand. as long as you stand for it and you stand with it. I just want to be sure that you guys know that. You heard that, don't you? There he is. Has he made it back from the car yet? Clifford Beach, honey, wherever you are, where'd you go? All right, ladies and gentlemen.
Hey, we're going impromptu. Let's whoever wants to speak.
That's right. Okay, well, while we're waiting for Cliff,
there's Fred Hammond down there.
That's what I was about to say. I'm going to go ahead and put up our gentleman who was, bless his heart. He responded to me at the last minute, and I forgot to call him for the last minute. He's one of the original speakers from the Roy Moore rally up in January. And someone who's an absolute inspiration to me. Every time I call him, I'm always in desperation, or I'm always at the bottom of my barrel, and he always puts a smile on my face. I think he can do the same for you. Please welcome to the stage the Reverend Fred Hammond.
I'm gonna sit down because I'm scheduled to have a nerve block done tomorrow on my back, and so it would be easier for me to just sit.
Okay. Well, we appreciate you coming.
Yes, we do.
We've been standing here for quite a while today awaiting the verdict that Judge Morris found guilty of violating the Supreme Court orders to enforce marriage equality in this state. Judge Moore believes that he is above the law of the land. He believes he is called to impose his brand of religion onto the citizens of this state. He believes that his brand of religion is the one true faith, that he has the pure and unadulterated interpretation of the Hebrew and Christian scriptures, that all other interpretations of these sacred texts are heresy and therefore should be purged from the state of Alabama. However, Judge Moore does not live in a country where only one religion is declared the official government religion, where only one interpretation of that religion is sanctioned, where other religions are persecuted. The United States does not have an official government-sanctioned religion. Here we have religious pluralism and the promise of religious freedom for all religions to not only be practiced, but to have their rituals protected and recognized by the government.
Yes!
This protection is found in our nation's most sacred of texts, a text that Judge Moore vowed to uphold in his role as judge, from the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all people are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator certain unalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Yes!
From the preamble of the Constitution of the United States, we, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. In the Constitution, the First Amendment, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. From the 14th Amendment of the Constitution, Section 1, all persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. It is from these documents that I sit here today to proclaim that my faith, which teaches me to love one another, no matter who you are or whom you love, is to be respected under this Constitution. My religion, which while a minority religion in the state of Alabama, has under the U.S. Constitution the legal and moral authority to have its marriages recognized by the government of these states. This right has been denied the members of my faith and other faiths for decades. It was a right that was finally recognized by the Supreme Court as being fully constitutional. Roy Moore and his ilk want to deny people who do not agree with his religious faith their rights as citizens of these United States. The followers of his religious faith are not hindered in any way by the practices of those who follow another faith or who follow no faith, just as my faith is not hindered in any way by the practices of his. Where hindrance occurs is when followers of his faith demand that I and others adhere to his faith tenets. In countries where there is one sanctioned religion, his approach would be legal. But here in the United States, all people are free to practice their faith. All people have the right to pursue happiness. But here is the thing. Judge Moore's faith doesn't even follow the tenets of his religion. His professed religion is Christianity. Jesus declared that for his followers, what? Jesus declared that for his followers, and I am reading from the King James Version, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Judge Moore violates this commandment. He is not loving his neighbor. His behavior shows no respect for the diversity of his neighbors. His behavior shows only contempt, which goes against his very faith, which insists on following the author of love by doing unto others as you would have them do unto you. I feel sorry for Judge Moore. I do, truly. I feel sorry for him because he has no love in his heart. He has walled himself off from knowing the freedom that divine love gives to each of us when we are willing to be embraced by that love. He is afraid. And in his fear, he attacks others who have found the freedom that love bestows. The love for one another is expressed in the Christian scriptures of Galatians 3:28. Here is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male and female, for you are one in Christ Jesus. Afraid of each other any longer, because when love is present, when love is placed at the center of our hearts, the need to separate us into categories falls away. The desire for ensuring mutual respect for our differences rises to the fore. But Judge Moore has not experienced the very redemption his Christian faith teaches him. Redemption is more than just reciting a few words on a page. And the redemption I am talking about is not just in the life to come, but redemption in this life. Freedom in this life, which our founding parents of this nation in their wisdom codified into law. The redemption of being able to have life and the pursuit of happiness. He does not know this redeeming love. He only knows hatred for others who not only are different than he is, but have found happiness and love through that difference.
the Bible and the Constitution.
He is going to eat a bit of a nudge from today to be told once again that he does not have the right to enforce his hatred unto the citizens of Alabama. He does not have the right to impose his version of Christianity unto the citizens of Alabama, who have found the power of love through other Christian denominations, through Judaism, through Islam, through Buddhism, through Baha'i, through Sikhism, through Taoism, through atheism, through humanism, through Jainism, through Wiccan, through indigenous faith, yes, even through my faith, Unitarian Universalism. Judge Moore, you betrayed the trust of the state of Alabama by violating our most sacred creeds as a nation. Not just once, but twice. You must be removed from this office today. And you cannot be allowed to serve a public office again because you have proven yourself to not being able to hold the people's rights above your own interests and agendas. And that all people have the right to experience love and have that love recognized by the government.
Thank you!
Oh, well, thank you so very much. You know, it often strikes me, you know, earlier, I want y'all to remember something. What I've been telling y'all all morning, you know, let us not interact with those who have been identified by the Federal Bureau of Investigation as domestic terrorists. But I also don't want you to believe that that is the face of Christianity and that is the face of God, because we all know it's not. We all know it's not. The only people who don't know is the people who have no respect for others. I spoke with a man from the other side of the fence just a few minutes ago up here on these steps. We were able to come together. We had a difference of opinion, but we had respect for each other and respect for ourselves. And that is the true source of Christian behavior. That is the true source of civilization. That is how we build a strong country together. It is when we put our differences aside and stand together to preserve the freedoms for all of us that we are truly walking in the steps of the Founding Fathers. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, if you would please help me welcome to the stage another gentleman who stood on the stage with us up there in January. He was freezing then, but he's roasting now. Y'all give it up for Equality Birmingham, Mr. Clifford Beach.
What kind of perverted mess is that? You know, no wonder you commit suicide because you deny who God is, and you don't have a basis left. You deny God, well, you don't break your neck over on your little high heels. Anyway, wake it up and be a man, get rid of those filthy clothes you got on and that perverted mind, and stand for right and truth. You need to be saved to what you're going to be. You need to be saved.
I've never asked this of a man before. Well, I'm not going to say that. No, I wouldn't ask this of a man because I consider to be a bottom. But I'm going to need you to use your big mouth, okay? I tell you, you find the truth, but just use your big mouth.
I'll use my big mouth. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Clifford Beach, and I am the board chair for Steel City Meeting Sports in Birmingham, Alabama. And before that, I was a volunteer for Equality Alabama leading up to the Birmingham Steering Committee
during the run-up to the U.S. Supreme Court's decision, which affirmed the right to marriage for gays and lesbians nationwide. I stayed with Quelle Obama on through Roy Moore's final act of defiance, which was last January, and that's what brought us here to this courthouse today for what I hope is the third and the very final time. I want to thank the Virgin Sterling and the Human Rights Campaign for inviting me back to speak to you today. It's a real honor. I remember just a few short months ago standing right up there, shivering, freezing, in some of the coldest weather of the year, and getting a report from the trenches about the reality of same-sex marriage in Alabama. That January protest against Roy Moore is part of what brought us here today. And even though my part was very small as it is today, I gotta say, that is probably one of the days I'm most proud of in all my life. Now I want to talk to you in this environment about numbers for just a second or two, so stick with me. Roy Moore and a lot of other Alabama politicians try to score points in any discussion about same-sex marriage, saying that 81% of Alabamians are against it. Their so-called proof comes from the 2006 Republican primary, which is the election that they chose for the vote on the sanctity of marriage. Now, sure enough, 81% of those who voted in favor of that amendment and against marriage equality. But what they don't tell you is that less than 900,000 people statewide voted. Less than 900,000. And based on that very small turnout, Roy Moore's, can't say his name, Reverend, his power snuck in a state constitutional amendment that I believe very few Alabamians actually cared about. Out of roughly 4.6 million Alabamians, the reality is that only 18% of the population voted at all. And of that, 15% voted for the sanctity of marriage amendment. Not 81% of the whole state, as Roy Moore likes to claim. This is political strategizing at its most manipulative. They knew their chances were slim at a broad-based election, so they tacked it on to an off-year primary when they knew turnout would be the lowest. Honestly, I have to give it to Roy and his band of thieves. It's a strategy that worked. They stole our rights. They limited our freedom in a nation that's all about expanding freedoms. Right here in Alabama, right here in America. Now, some would say that the percentages might have stayed the same no matter how many people voted. But here's the thing. I'm a gay man. And my husband is a gay man. And we got married. Not mock married, not gay married, but honest to goodness, married by a Presbyterian minister right here in Alabama. And I'm here to tell you that no one was mad about it. If 81% of the state was against my marriage, I think we would have heard something. It's not like we were little kids. Let's face it, we had more than 100 guests invited to a popular public park on a Saturday night, for goodness sake. The people, the lights, the rooms, it was pretty fantastic. All the vendors we dealt with, the people I met with, that I meet with in my business dealings, friends and neighbors, random people we met with along the way, no matter who they were, no matter where they were, no matter when or how we shared our news, every single person congratulated us, and most of them absolutely celebrated our engagement and our wedding. Roy Moore and his buddies in the legislature have it wrong. Alabama is not against same-sex marriage. Only that small minority they targeted in 2006, 10 years ago, who they knew would show up to vote in a trick election. They're the only ones who ever cared. I'm not a gambling man, but I bet if you could find those same voters today and ask them again what they thought about same-sex marriage, the results would be very, very different. And if it had ever gone to a full vote in a general election, then and especially now, one more
Moore and all of his and all of his shenanigans, they wouldn't even be a footnote to history. What we have today and what we had back then is a case of a handful of politicians and a couple of protesters, Roy Moore chief among them, who believe that their way of thinking should be everyone's way of thinking. Roy thinks he's smart enough, clever enough, and manipulative enough to force an entire state to fall in line with his very personal and very skewed way of thinking. He has a particular view of the law of the land and the Constitution that he swore to uphold and defend that doesn't line up with the rest of the state. Fortunately for us, and I think for the U.S. Constitution, that's not the way it works, Roy. Ambrosia Starling, this beautiful but outspoken and extremely polite drag queen who you all think, who Roy thinks should have been arrested for speaking
same-sex wedding right here at the state Supreme Court.
Chief Justice Roy Moore has been very righteous.
We're going to put this on.
We have to hate him.
What a generator.
You hate him. You don't want him to.
The generator.
That's right, honey. Oh, and don't try to tell me it's God that turned the generator off. It's science, honey. She ran out of gas.
So this is the first for me.
So as I'm saying, Ambrosia is a beautiful
Darling over here.
And kind of outspoken drag queen. Roy Moore thinks should have been arrested for speaking out against him and helping to facilitate an honest-to-goodness, real same-sex wedding right here at the state Supreme Court building. She's right when she says today's second action will have national consequences. You cannot defy the U.S. Supreme Court without paying the price. People like Ambrosia Starling, Timmy Willett, who sadly didn't live to see this day, Dr. Paul Hard, the Southern Poverty Law Center, and many others stood together and brought charges against Roy Moore, and the system worked. Roy Moore is in that courthouse today, fighting to keep his job and some kind of dignity, thinking that one way or another, whether he lives, whether he leaves a winner or a martyr, he's going to be one step closer to the governor's office. And let's just be clear about one thing. I don't think he's going to leave a martyr. That's his way of thinking about what's happening in that building. I think he's going to leave a loser without his job or his dignity. And based on the low numbers that he earned in the last three campaigns, he ran, and having trust in Alabama's voters, I doubt he'll ever shoot inside the governor's mansion. Fact-checking has become serious business these days because politicians try to get away with rewriting the past in their own favor. Roy Moore is trying to do that today. The problem with them is that we know the truth. Roy's so arrogant in his personal beliefs that run contrary to federal court rulings that he puts them in writing and repeated orders to Alabama's probate judges. Not only that, but there is plenty of video proof that Roy Moore consciously chose to place his personal views above the U.S. Constitution and the Supreme Court of the United States. In his now infamous interview with CNN's Chris Wolo, Roy claims the U.S. Supreme Court does not have the authority to interpret a word that is not in the U.S. Constitution. In other words, if it's not actually written in the body, if the vocabulary is not there, you can't talk about it. And the word that he was talking about, of course, was marriage. But, Roy, that's not the way it works. The justices get to use their entire vocabulary and interpret every issue that comes before them in light of the Constitution. That interview I'm talking about is long, but 19 minutes into it, Roy Moore himself actually cites the Supremacy Clause of the U.S. Constitution when he says that the Alabama courts are subject to the federal courts. Roy Moore said that. Further, he said that the Alabama judges are also subject to the Supreme Court. Then just moments later, when asked if he would follow the court, when it
ruled in favor of marriage equality, Roy said, and I quote, "I will recognize that the United States Supreme Court is binding over the state courts. For me," and I'm still voting for him, "I will make that decision about following court when the time comes. Roy Moore will make the decision whether or not to follow the Supreme Court's directive when it comes, even though he already knows or already knew at the time it was binding. That's not the way it works, Roy. My father, my uncle, my great uncle did not serve in the military and fight our country's wars so that you can refuse to respect and obey the United States Supreme Court. Who do you think you are? The arrogance of it, the gall, it's appalling. And today, it comes to an end. I grew up learning that justice is blind. There's a reason that the Statue of Justice is blindfolded while holding a scale in the balance. How else can we trust our government? We have to believe, no, we have to know. We have to know that our courts will treat us fairly. It's the cornerstone of our civilization. Nations with a corrupt judiciary fail, they rot from within. We can talk about the specifics, about every wrong thing Roy Moore has done. And hopefully that's what's going on inside this courthouse right now. But the bottom line is that he hurt Alabama and he's hurt America. Thanks to Roy Moore's many public professions against me and my people, I have zero confidence that any Alabama court will treat me fairly, and that's unfortunate. Roy thinks that all gays and lesbians, transgender people, drag queens as kings, everyone else addressed by those letters we go around, LGBTQ, is mentally ill. He thinks that if there is any real justice in the world, you and I would be arrested for being here today, exercising our right of free speech and peaceful assembly. He thinks that being gay is little different from bestiality. I know this because he said it again and again and again on national television, on radio, and in print. And he said it, and because he's backed it up in administrative orders to Alabama's judges, and because he's made a lot of money from saying these things and working to affect state and national cases through his foundations of moral law. There is no impartiality in him. He ripped that blindfold off, tilted the scale against you and me, and commenced the stare down that has gone a long time ago, it's going till today. Did you know that in 2002, Moore actually wrote in a court ruling, in a court opinion, that being gays, and sadly, I'm going to hold my hand to God, this is a quote, "Homosexuality is abhorrent, immoral, detestable, a crime against nature, and a violation of the laws of nature and of nature's God." And then he went on to say that the state carries the power of the sword, and that is the power to prohibit conduct with physical penalties, such as confinement, putting us in jail, and execution just for being gay. That's the kind of man that we have who's supposed to impartially piece out the law as Chief Justice of the Alabama Supreme Court. This is a man with a very peculiar religious and legal belief system, and he can't separate the two. There's a reason the Los Angeles Times calls him the Ayatollah of Alabama. There's a reason Chris Cuomo in that live interview said, "I don't know how you can be the Chief Justice of a court and not follow the laws of the land." The Christian Science Monitor says, in the understatement of the year, Roy Moore blurs the line between judge and politician. But I think Kyle Whitmire at AL.com said it best. He said it best back in May when he wrote, "There's an important thing to know about Moore. He autographs Bible. He'll put his signature on the Constitution and Declaration of Independence like he wrote things, and that giant monument to the Ten Commandments, at the base of the stone block, there was a little C circling around it next to his name." That's right, he's a copywriter. Moore doesn't only believe that God's coming back, he thinks until then the Almighty has given him the power of attorney over his affairs. Judge Grenade, first ruled in favor of marriage equality in Alabama. Roy wrote a letter to Governor Bentley. In it, he said, our state and our morality are under attack by a federal court. He actually thinks he's at war with the federal government. That ship sailed, Roy. Thank God this now lost. We need the protection of the United States Constitution against him, against Roy. And here's the irony of it all. And the very same letter, Roy railed against judicial tyranny and unlawful opinions issued without constitutional authority. Those are books. Now he's on trial for abusing the power of his office, becoming a judicial tyrant himself, and defying the constitutional authority of the United States Supreme Court to the detriment of the people of Alabama. The very thing that he says that he's against, he's actually become. I told you before, every Alabamian we met celebrated our marriage, and they did. And quite honestly, they still do. It's a beautiful thing. I was still expecting a painful pushback against us, and so shocked, pleased, and gratified when I discovered the reality of how loving and accepting Alabamians are, that I really can't fully express it. But that doesn't mean that we can claim no harm, no foul when it comes to Roy Moore. There have been damages. Our insurance agent, just to be personal about this for a moment, our insurance agent had to be reassured that our marriage was legal in Alabama before she could find our insurance policies. Shelby County Probate Judge Furmeister told me on February 9, 2015, when marriage first became legal, that he wouldn't issue marriage licenses to anyone, gay or straight, because he was caught between two activist judges. Of course, he wasn't. He made a choice to follow Roy Moore that day. And even now, our marriage certificate, brought by Lynn in Shelby County, even now, our marriage certificate, which is signed by Judge Burmeister, has the word marriage stripped from it. Ron and I don't have a marriage certificate. We have a certificate.
My right.
At least Shelby County's doing that much. There's still a handful of counties that don't offer marriage licenses at all. Protest the same-sex marriage. And this is all because Roy Moore and the use of power. He gives credence to discrimination that percolates throughout the state, and that hurts everyone. We can't trust you, Roy. You're a danger to democracy. Your judicial actions are all suspect and tainted by your very single-minded view of the world. There is nothing you can say that carries any moral weight or authority. You cause damage to the people of the state, and it is time for you to go, because this is the way it works.
I heard somebody saying that God that knocked me down, well, on these rough steps, I didn't even scuff my pantyhose, so it was God that caught me and took me back up. At this time, you know, I'd like to ask, actually, I see they're back here with us in a moment. Is there anyone from the sisters who would like to speak?
All right.
Yes.
All right.
All
right. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to, you know, an organization that has been doing a lot of work for many years to help the AIDS community. And I'd like to introduce you to someone who has been...
Court is adjourned.
Oh, Court, well, that's it. Baby, Court is adjourned. Church is not.
There you go.
If you would, please.
Welcome to the stage. She's known as Sister Gretchen from the Sisterhood of Perpetual Indulgence.
All right.
It's so wonderful that we could all come together for our cause today, and I think that Ambrosia needs a wonderful round of applause.
We love you, Ambrosia. We love you. Thank you. Thank you. Ambrosia,
your governor!
Ambrosia, your governor!
You know, here's the thing that I keep thinking over and over. It doesn't matter the kind of work that we've been doing it for 8 years, raising money for HIV/AIDS, raising money for women's causes, and raising money for awareness of LGBTQ community and all of its needs.
Now we're back on gas. But I just want you to know that the sisters are here. We're here to help. Any nonprofit organization is always welcome to come to the sisters and always welcome to apply. We will always help or consider your application. We help so many people in the community and so many people in the state. And that's our main purpose and main calling. We have, in this United States, we have 37 states with sisters, and we have 17 foreign countries with sisters. There are sisters all over the world, and we're there for that reason. That is our main calling. Thank you so much for helping today with all that we've done. I feel like there's something that we need to remember. One thing that bothers me so much as hearing all the rhetoric from the other side is, do you not understand that when something goes before the Supreme Court and they make a decision, that's the law. That's the way it is. So, because of their lack of understanding that that's the way it is and that's the bottom line, I pray that they don't get in trouble, because one day they may end up in front of the Supreme Court and somebody say, oh, let's not accept that decision if it's in their favor. So I want everyone to remember, we are upholding the law. They are not. Also, we may not get a ruling today, but I'll tell you what, there will be a ruling, and it will be just, because the law is the law. So do not be disheartened if it is not today. We're praying that it will be here in just a few minutes, since they have adjourned, but it may not. I loved all the speakers. Every speaker that came up here today was wonderful. Thank you so much for your time and all of your words of wisdom and effort. I'm going to tell you a little story about the sisters. When we first started Sisters, one of the things that we did, we went into the bars and we gave out pamphlets. We talked to other people, and I had a guy come up to me, and he told me, he said, my partner is over here, and he just found out today that he's HIV positive. Can you go talk to him? So I went to talk to him, and he poured his heart out, and he talked to me and told me that he had bought a bunch of pills that he was going to take that night. And that he was ending his life so that he wouldn't be a burden for his boyfriend. After a long talk with him, he agreed to go home and begin the medication. 3 years later, I was in a bar in Birmingham after a bingo game that we had to raise money. And this guy comes up to me and he told me, he says, I'm the guy you talked to that night. And I said, well, thank God you didn't kill yourself. I said, what happened? And he told me, he said, I got active and I got involved. Being active and involved is the key to our success. That is what will see us through. That is what will make each of us stronger. And that is what will make our cause go forward. And it will go forward with your help.
Because of its egregious sin and its destruction.
I love hearing all of this. I'm an ordained Baptist minister. I've been in Baptist ministry, a Southern Baptist ministry, been in Baptist ministry for 32 years. But my God teaches me that He loves me. My God teaches me that He loves them. My God teaches me that He loves everybody. And that He alone is the judge. No one else is the judge of our own lives. And when we stand before Him, He will be the one that decides whether we go to heaven or hell, not these people. So, when someone tells you you're not doing right, I ask you to reflect inwardly and pray about it. And if you have not been convicted to do otherwise, continue on the path you're on. That's why I'm where I am, and that's why I've done this for 8 years. God bless you. Thank you for everything. And thank you, HRC, also, for all the wonderful help and leadership.
We love the Magic City Sisters!
You know, what they do is so very important to appeal to everyone in our community. I do want to take a time and a moment to reach out in here real quick and touch on that particular subject. It's a subject that's, you know, was near and dear to my heart for many years. You know, that's what got me started in being active and doing things for my community. Back in 1993, when I first started as an entertainer, I had a very dear friend of mine who was a mentor. And back then, there was not a lot that an AIDS outreach organization could do for anyone. All they could do was give you a prescription you could not afford to fill, and a 24-pack of Ensure, and a pat on the hand, and say, "We hope we see you next month." I didn't understand what that meant. I didn't understand. I was young. I was foolish. I was wrapped up in my own business. But that third month when I took her back for that monthly visit, and I saw that secretary reaching out to every single hand that touched that counter and saying, "We hope we see you next month." What she was saying was that, "We hope you survive to come back in 30 days. We hope you survive to come back." These equality organizations can do a lot, these outreach organizations for AIDS work can do a lot more, but they can't do it without your help. They still need matching funds to get those federal funds. They still need your help. Yes, the position is better, but it's not gone, it's not done, it's not over with. You know, the Magic City Sisters, you know, give them a shout out one more time. Yeah. Because it is a struggle for all of these organizations, especially now that our state has decided that they will contribute $11 million to be part of a bathroom lawsuit, but they can't fund Medicaid. They can't fund Medicaid for HIV patients. They can't fund Medicaid for senior citizens. They can't fund state troopers. They can't fund veterans' benefits, but they can fund discrimination. That's what we need to stop by participating and voting. It is your time. I know our community for a long time. We didn't vote. They weren't caring about us. Why was we caring about what was going on up in there? We didn't participate because they weren't including us. Guess what? Now they are. So now, stand up and participate. If you are not registered, get registered. You can get registered online in any state you live in. You can get registered for 5 minutes of your time and zero dollars. It won't cost you a thing. But if you don't register and you don't vote, it will cost you your freedom. Don't let that happen in Alabama. If you got friends there, wherever they are, don't let it happen in America. It's time. Your vote is your voice. Your voice only does it matter.